بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. القول مني في جميع الأشياء قول آل محمد عليهم السلام، فيما أسروا وما أعلنوا وفيما بلغني عنهم وما لم يبلغني. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أفضل الأنبياء والمرسلين، حبيبي إله العالمين أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد، وعلى آل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين الذي أذهب عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا، واللعن الدائم على أعدائهم أجمعين من الآن إلى قيام يوم الدين، آمين رب العالمين. My dear brothers and sisters, I begin in the name of Allah, the most beneficent and the most merciful. All praise be to Him. And I send my peace and blessings upon Muhammad and his holy progeny and my eternal damnation and my curses upon their enemies from today until the day of judgment. Ameen Rabbil Alameen. My dear brothers and sisters, I want to welcome you to the holy sacred site of my two Imams, Al-Hasan Al-Askari and his father Imam Al-Hadi, peace be upon them. We are now, directly behind us lies the beautiful transcendent dome, this beautiful new dome of Al-Askari alayhi salam that was finally installed this year. Since the attack on the dome of Al-Askari, peace be upon them, in the year 2006 till today, meaning the year 2015, the believers in the Shia of the Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam did not have a dome to come to, did not have the shrine, the sacred sanctuary itself was mostly ruins. And right now, if you are sitting where I'm sitting, as you look at the beautiful city of Samarra, most of it is abandoned homes and ruined houses. Of course, that is because of the enemies of the Ahlul Bayt, peace be upon them, that continue till today. They try to distinguish this light, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَاللَّهُ مُتِمَّ نُورِهِ وَلَوْ كَرِهَ الْكَافِرُونَ أَوْ الْمُشْرِكُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that this light that the unbelievers, the kuffar, that wish to distinguish, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, this light will continue to shine and continue to be burning, even if the disbelievers do not like that. Even if the kuffar or the mushrikeen find it that they don't like this matter, that this light continues. And of course, this light is nothing but Ahlul Bayt alayhi wasalam. And like Sayyidah Zainab alayhi wasalam said, and I know we repeated this in various different programs, but as she said to Yazid, Wallah ya Yazid, lam tamhu dhikrana Ahlul Bayt. You will never erase our dhikr, our remembrance, because our remembrance, it lives in the heart. And as you can see behind me right now, we're sitting in the sacred site of my master Imam Al-Askari alayhi salam and my master Imam Al-Hadi alayhi salam, and as well you have the pure body and the pure grave of our Sayyidah As-Siddiqa At-Tahira As-Sayyidah Narjis, the mother of Imam Al-Mahdi alayhi salam, and you also have the aunt of Imam Al-Askari alayhi salam, Sayyidah Hakima, and also you have Hussein, who is the brother of Al-Askari alayhi salam and the brother of Sayyid Muhammad, who was also buried in this beautiful location. And on top of all that, you have Sardab al-Ghaiba, the basement in which Imam al-Mahdi, ajallahu ta'ala farajahu al-sharif wa ruhu al-fida, was the last location in which Imam al-Mahdi alayhi wasalam was seen before he went into, of course, his minor occultation, and then after he was seen again by the pious scholars, and then, of course, right now we are in the period of the major occultation. But this area, or these lands that we are standing on, these are very precious land. They are very sacred lands, especially that this used to be the house of Imam Al-Hadi alayhi salam, when Al-Mutawakkil Al-Abbasi and all the Abbasids, of course, when they tried to move their seat of government to where? To Samarra, because they thought they have Baghdad already, but why not prepare a new seat of government and let's go to Samarra. When the Abbasid ruler at the time, what did he do? He called for Al-Hasan, for Imam Al-Hadi alayhi salam. Imam Al-Hadi alayhi salam came with his son Al-Askari alayhi salam to Samarra. The ahadith tell us that the Imam alayhi salam had purchased this land. I think the amount was approximately 10,000 dirhams or dinars from a Christian pastor, from a Christian man that used to live in these areas. Meaning these imams are the only imams that are buried in their own houses, of course, not excluding that of the Rasulullah. The Rasulullah was also born in his own house, and his own house is also his masjid. But that's why there is a special sanctity that surrounds this place that you won't find anywhere else, because the other locations where the imams are buried, technically, yes, they were bought beforehand, but they're not a house per se. And we read in the Quran that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells the believers in general that do not enter the houses of the prophets and the messengers unless he gives you thy permission. Our ulama, by the way, just so people can know this, especially the pioneers from them, for example, Shaykh al-Mufid, Shaykh al-Mashhadi in his Mazar al-Kabir, Shaykh al-Saduq, these are some of them, and I might be mistaken, but some of these ulama, the pioneers, so the mutaqaddimeen from the ulama, some of these ulama from ours, such as Shaykh al-Saduq, like I said, Tusi and Mufid, if you read, for example, the Misbah of Shaykh al-Tusi, or you read the Mazar of Shaykh al-Mufid, I think, or Shaykh al-Mashhadi, you will discover that when they speak about the ziyarah of Imam al-Hasan al-Askari, Imam al-Hadi, peace be upon them, and they begin to narrate the ziyarah itself, you read that it says, وَإِنْ وَصَلْتَ إِلَىٰ بَابِ الْإِمَامِ فَزُرْهُ مِنْ بُعُدْ. That means, do not enter the house of the Imam alayhi salam, but in fact visit him from behind the hijab, from behind the limits of the house. Of course, the fuqaha now have changed his opinion. So right now you see the Shia entering and leaving the shrine. But why did the fuqaha make it mubah, make it halal, make it lawful for us to enter the shrine of the Imam alayhi salam, when the Imam is not actually in our presence for us to be, to tell him, Ya Mawlai, can you please give me permission to come into your house? Of course, there are hadith from the Ahlul Bayt alayhim wassalam that have stated that Imam al-Sadiq, I think, was the narrator in one of the hadith, or one of the imams, wherein the hadith states that وَلَقَدْ أَبَاحَ وَلَقَدْ أَبَحْنَا, or what we made mubah for our Shia min حُقُوِقِنَا, that from our rights that we have, our assets, we have made it lawful for our Shia. And of course, we also have the ahadith found in the books of Mazar, in the books of Ziyara, that speak of, or that narrate, for example, if you open Fatiha Jinan of Al-Muhadith Al-Qummi alayhi ar-Rahmatu wa Ridwan, you discover that there are specific sections of the Ziyara wherein the Muhadith Al-Qummi has narrated, for example, وَإِذَا أَرَدْتَ زِيَارَةَ قَبْرَ الْحُسَيْنِ وَإِذَا أَرَدْتَ زِيَارَةَ الْعَسْكَرِي فَقِفْ عِنْدَ الْبَابِ وَعِنْدَ الْحَائِرِ وَقْرَى الْإِذْنِ لِلْدُخُولِ. That when you arrive to the shrine of Al-Husayn alayhi salam, or the shrine of Al-Askariyain, that when you reach the door, recite the sigha, the context or the script for entrance. أَتَأْذُنِي يَا اللَّهِ أَتَأْذُنِي يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. For example, that, oh Allah, do you grant me permission? Oh Muhammad, do you grant me permission? Oh Hussein, do you grant permission? And then, of course, then it says that after you complete this, technically you have been given that permission to enter the house. So that is just a side note, because the topic that I would like to really speak about today, since I am in this sacred divine shrine, where my Imam al-Mahdi alayhi wa salam wa ajal ta'ala farajul sharif was last seen in Sardab al-Ghaiba, and I thought that it would be very appropriate to take this time, or whatever time I have, especially that I'm in this beautiful location and the sacred site and the beautiful scenery of Samarra, the city of Samarra. Honestly, the atmosphere in Samarra is something that is unexplainable. Arba'een has atmosphere, Karbala has an atmosphere, but knowing that Samarra has this atmosphere that surrounds it, that you see Shia from all over the local cities come, and you see that Samarra is approximately only 60 to 70 kilometers away from At-Tikrit or other districts and other cities that were known to be districts and cities that support terrorism, that support Irhab, they support these extremist groups that have no religion whatsoever, these extremist groups that do what? That kill the Shia, that kill the Shia for no apparent reason, that kill the Shia because why? Because they say that we love Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam. But to see that Samarra, after the istishhad of Imam al-Hasan al-Askari alayhi salam, the Shia in Samarra from all over, they flock towards Samarra. And the Samarra that the Abbasids, that al-Mutawakkil and al-Mu'tasim wanted to build fell apart. And now if you look at the map of Samarra, you will discover that the beginning of Samarra began where? At the shrine of al-Askariyin alayhum as-salam. And it's as if the homes and the homes surrounding the shrine after a long period of time expanded to the city we see today. And then if you see the city limits, for example the Malwiya, which is one of those structures that was built during the time of the Abbasids, which was in a helical shaped structure, a structure that was used for Adhan. If you look at the maps, the old maps, you will find that this structure is located outside the area wherein the Imams are. So you would see the Imams alayhi salam, you would see cities covering the Imam, and then you would see a gate, then you would see the Malwiya, this location wherein Adhan was recited during the time of the Abbasids. Because the Samarra that they wanted to build fell apart. The Samarra that lives today is the Samarra of al-Hasan al-Askari alayhi salam. The Samarra that during the time of al-Mirza Muhammad Hassan al-Shirazi al-Mujaddid al-Awwal, he made this location into what? A beautiful house, first of its kind. All of these houses you see around me, by the Imam alayhi salam, behind the Imam, in front of the Imam, right and left to the Imam, they were all students of the Hawza. The Mujaddid al-Shirazi wanted to come and place a footstep in history and open al-Hawza al-Askariya, the Hawza of al-Hasan al-Askari and Imam al-Hadi alayhi salam. Now to go to the topic at hand, which is the topic that of the divine nomination of Imama alayhi salam. Now Imama is something so holy. Imama is something very sacred. And what I want to, the reason that I want to speak about Imama today is I want to try my best, of course. And of course I will never reach that point where I will be able to truly understand what Imama is and what Wilaya is. But we want to give you, my dear viewers, the weight of Imama. How heavy is Imama? Is Imama something simplified? Or is Imama something heavy? And we will look at the Quran al-Kareem. And inshallah, we will try to connect that with Imam al-Mahdi alayhi salam in the Quran. What does the Quran say about the dhuhur, about the appearance of al-Mahdi al-Muntadhar, ajallahu ta'ala farajhu sharif? Now let's say one thing. Imama is divine. Imama comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wilaya is nothing but that comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And wilaya and imama is not something that is inherited from father to son. Why? What do we look? We look at Imam Ali alayhi salam, then we look at Hassan and Hussein. Hussein's dhurriya. After Hussein, who was Hussein? As-Sajjad alayhi salam. Was As-Sajjad the oldest of the sons of Hussein alayhi salam? No. Ali al-Akbar was the oldest. So these lessons that we find in the lineage of the Ahlul Bayt, the 12 Imams, you see that it was not always the oldest son that gained Imamah. In the terms of Imam Al-Hasan Al-Askari alayhi salam, the oldest son was Sayyid Muhammad. Sayyid Muhammad Sab'ud-Dijjal was born in the year 291 after Hijrah. Abu Muhammad Al-Askari was born in the year 231 or 232 after Hijrah. The hadith here, there's a hadith that is narrated. Let me read the hadith. This nas here, this explicit nomination, is narrated by Sheikh al-Saffar, Muhammad ibn Hassan al-Saffar, in his book Basair al-Darajat, on the authority of Ali ibn Abdullah ibn Marwan al-Anbari. He said, I was present when Abu Ja'far is the kunya of Sayyid Muhammad, the son of al-Hadi, peace be upon him, passed away. My master Abu al-Hassan al-Hadi brought forth a chair and sat on it, while Abu Muhammad al-Askari alayhi salam was standing at his side, meaning Imam al-Hasan al-Askari. When Abu al-Hasan completed the funeral processions of his son Abu Ja'far, he looked at his son Abu Muhammad and said, O son, give thanks to Allah for what he has decreed, for he made this important matter rest upon you. Now there is another hadith here that is narrated by Ahmad ibn Isa al-Alawi, who is from the progeny of Ali ibn Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salam. He says, we entered upon Abu al-Hasan in Samarra and greeted him. As we completed our greetings, we noticed that Abu Ja'far, Sayyid Muhammad al-Dijiyal, and Abu Muhammad al-Hasan al-Askari alayhim as-salam had entered behind us. We rose from our seats in order to greet Abu Ja'far, thinking that Abu Ja'far will be the Imam, because Abu Ja'far had such high qualities and such nobility that people actually thought he was the Imam, to the point that there is a sect called Al-Muhammadiyya, but of course a sect can no longer be found in history today, or of course in our era today, that actually fell to the imamah of Sayyid Muhammad Sab'ud Dijil alayhi salam. And then of course here Abu al-Hasan al-Hadi said, he is not your divine leader, your patron in this matter, for go towards the divine authority. Then he pointed towards his son Abu Muhammad al-Askari alayhi salam. So you see that wilaya, this authority, this divine covenant, that this individual who was the recipient of the divine supreme covenant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is not inherited, but in fact Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who has organized everything. What do we read in Ziyat Ashura? How do I connect to Ziyat Ashura? Ziyat Ashura says, الَّذِينَ أَزَالَكُمْ عَنْ مَرَاتِبِكُمْ أَلَّتِي رَتَّبَكُمُ اللَّهُ فِيهَا. May Allah's damnation and curses be upon those who altered this divine command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who moved you from the locations in which you were supposed to be situated in, who puts you, Ali, as fourth when you, Ali, are first. Of course, we believe as a Shia that whatever this fourth being Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam, this is just on the hukm al-dhahiri, bin ma in the hukm al-batini, the inner governance and the inner wilayah, the divine wilayah, not the wilayah of this world. No, the wilayah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in fact Ali ibn Talib alayhi salam. And the proof of wilayah lies in the Quran. Now, we want to look at some ayat in the Quran, some verses in the Quran concerning wilayah. So, before we do that, inshallah, what we will do is we will take a short break, and then inshallah we will continue. And we have approximately 2 to 3 verses that speak about wilayah. So inshallah, please stay tuned with us. Wassalamu alaikum.